Today we are going to continue with the topic of horizontal curves, and what we were doing last time was discussing different types of horizontal curves. So there were four types: simple, compound, reverse, and transition or spiral. And basically we discussed all of them, and there is something which is left for the spiral or the transition curve. So I explained to you that the purpose of giving a spiral and a transition curve is to provide the change in curvature, either from a tangent to a curve or from one curve to another curve. And I showed you some equations to calculate the minimum length of the spiral curve. So these are the equations, and you have them in both unit systems. Okay, so these are in feet, and this one is in meters. And then for this one, you only need the value of P and R in meters. Okay, and this is the value of P in meters. Now, in that lecture, I also told you that one of the reasons of providing a spiral curve is to have the change in the cross slope of the road. So on the curve, the slope of the road, the cross section slope of the road is supposed to be like this. This is a super elevation, raised outside edge of the road. Okay, and this is supposed to be like this. But the normal slope of the road before the curve is this one. Okay, so you can see the difference. So to convert this slope into this one, I need a gradual change. And this gradual change happens partly on the spiral curve, partly. Okay. So to change the normal slope into super elevation, there are two steps. One is known as tangent runout, and the other one is known as super elevation runoff. Okay. What is the tangent runout? When the normal slope changes to flat or zero slope. So this is the normal slope, and this is, you can see, it has changed to zero, flat. Okay, now this one is already according to the super elevation I want. See this one? I don't need to change this one, right? This is already in the same direction. Okay, I don't need to change. But this one was tilted the other way, so I have to change it to flat, and then from flat it goes to super elevation. So when you change normal to flat, it is known as tangent runout. And when you change it from flat to full super elevation, it is known as super elevation runoff. Okay, so tangent runout is when you change the normal slope to flat, and super elevation runoff is when you change the flat elevation. Okay, now as you can see from the name that the tangent runout would happen on the tangent. Okay, and super elevation runoff happens on the spiral curve. Okay, so the spiral curve starts from here when the slope is flat, and it ends when the slope attains full super elevation. So this is the end of the spiral curve. Okay, now thanks to Dr. Sami, who was teaching highway with me last semester, till last semester, I was able to attain this 3D diagram. So it becomes easier for me to explain, right? Otherwise in 2D, it is hard to explain. Anyways, so now let us look at the equations for super elevation runoff and tangent runout. We'll start with super elevation runoff. So this is the equation. LR is super elevation runoff. W is the width of the lane. Width of the lane. Okay. Normally this is 12 feet. We have discussed it in this chapter earlier as well, but it can have any other value as well. Then N1 is the number of lanes rotated. N1 is the number of lanes rotated. Okay. Rotated means for how many lanes you are changing the slope. For how many lanes you are changing the slope. For example, if you come here, okay, so this is the normal slope. Now you are changing this lane, right? You are rotating this lane, you are changing the slope of this lane, right? So if it is a two lane road, okay, and the slope is changed from the center line, then you are rotating one lane, right? For this line, I'm doing nothing. This is already according to the slope I want. Okay, so I'm rotating this lane. Okay, so if it's a two lane road, then N1 becomes one. Okay, if it's a three lane, then N1 becomes 1.5, right? Because from the center line, so three lane, from the center line, you will have 1.5 lanes on each direction. Then four lanes and N1 will become two and so on. Okay, so N1 is the number of lanes for which you are changing the lanes for which you are raising the slope, right? This one, okay, on the outside edge of the center line. The edge of the center line. Then ED is the super elevation you want to achieve, okay? And BW is an adjustment factor. Okay, so you can see the values of the adjustment factor. So if it is one lane rotated, then it's one. it is 0.3, it is 1.5 lanes, and it is 0.83, and so on. Okay, so it depends upon how many lanes you are rotating. The value of N1, the value of N1 will give you the value of BW. Okay. What else? Yeah. So why do we need BW? Now you can see BW is either 1 or less than 1. So if you remove BW, then either you will get the value of LR equal to this ratio, or maybe LR equals to BW is, let's say, 0.83. Then you multiply something with 0.83 or something with fraction will reduce the value. So BW is basically an adjustment factor for reducing the value of LR. Okay, it will either keep the value of LR as it is, or it will reduce it. For one lane, it will keep it as it is, but for more than one lane, it will reduce it. Okay, so it goes up to 3.5 lanes, means it can have 7 lanes. You can use it up to 7 lanes. And normally on the curves, the number of lanes are very, very few, like 2 or 3 lanes, and that's it. Because on the curves, obviously the speed is less and so on. If we increase the number of lanes, it will become dangerous. Okay. So what I was saying is BW is an adjustment factor, a check factor to make sure the LR is under practical limits. Okay. Otherwise, if BW is not here, then you may get the value of super elevation runoff as 300 feet, 400 feet, which is not practical. Okay, it's just the length given for change of slope. Okay, so it cannot be, you know, the length as a curve, the length of the curve, right? So this is just a small part of the road. Okay, so we want to keep it as small as possible. So LR is that check value. Okay, and then we have delta. Okay, which is the maximum relative gradient. Okay, so it is basically the rate of change of gradient. So the gradient is changing, right? Change the gradient from flat to full super elevation. So at what rate it is changing, like the change in the gradient upon the length. It is something like this, like the K factor. We remember we discussed the K factor for the vertical curves. It is a thing similar to that. Okay, so the percentage change per feet of the distance. Okay, so the table is given here. Again, it's in miles per hour, like we have been doing it, or we have been using it for the entire book. So speed in miles per hour, and you get the value of delta, okay, and so on. Now, if you we have a table as well for LR, and this table can help you get the value of LR for few cases. Which cases are those? Now you have the design speed here. Okay, so design speed is not a problem. It is going from 220 to 80, not a problem. Super elevation from 1.5 to 12%. Again, it covers the. The problem is, first of all, if you look at the bottom, lane width 12 feet. So if lane width is not 12 feet, then you cannot use the table. Okay. Secondly, N1 and 2. The table is only limited to an N1 value of 1 and 2. Okay. So if you have more than two lanes rotated, if N1 is more than 2, then you cannot use this table. Okay. So you have a table, you can just take the value, you know the value of the speed and the super elevation, you can, and N1, you can find out the LR directly, but the table will not work if the number of lanes rotated are more than 2 or the lane width is not 12 feet. Then you go back to the equation. Okay, now let us look at an example. We want to design a spiral curve, so we want to know the length of the spiral curve, and these are the conditions. Okay, now the first condition is given for the equation of the spiral curve itself, the minimum length of the spiral curve. So these are the things we need to calculate the minimum length of the spiral curve without considering anything else, without considering the super elevation. So we need the radius. Radius is given. We need the design speed. It is given. P value, the lateral offset, is given. And the rate of increase of radial acceleration is given, 2 feet per square second per second. Now don't worry about these values. These are given in miles per hour in feet. So we have the equation in miles per hour in feet. Okay, if these values are, if you want the values in meters, then obviously radius and speed will be given, but P and radial acceleration are given here in meters as well. See, value of C and P is given in meters as well. Okay, so if the problem changes, you can have the value of the constants here. Okay, don't worry about what will happen to you then. So let us, using this condition, let us use the equation of the spiral curve to find out the minimum length. Now we had two equations for the length of the spiral curve. And this is the first equation. So u, and this is, these are the equations in feet, because the data is given in feet, so the equations are in feet. Now u is 60 miles per hour. Okay, you will put u as 60, no conversion required here. R is 800 feet, put it as it is, and c is 2 feet per square second per second. Okay, so you put c as 2 here. So L minimum comes out to be 425.25 feet from the first equation. Need P minimum, R minimum is 0.66 feet. And again, you don't need any conversion if both values are in feet. The answer will be in feet, which is 88.99 feet. Okay, so using the two equations of the spiral curve, I'm getting these two values. Okay, now both equations are for the minimum criteria. Okay, so which value should I pick from these two? I'll pick the higher one. Why? Because if you pick this one, 88.99, then you are not satisfying the criteria of the first equation. Okay, but if I pick 425.25, I'm fulfilling the minimum criteria from both equations. Okay, so I'll pick 425.25 feet. Now, you see the second condition is given according to the super elevation runoff conditions, super elevation runoff data. Okay, so lane width is 12 feet, super elevation 4%, two lanes, okay. So two lanes mean one lane rotated, right? Two lanes means one lane is rotated and 2% normal cross flow. Okay, if we come here. Now, since the lane width is 12 feet and number of lanes rotated, N1 is 1, so I can use the table. Okay, like I always do, I select the easiest example for the class, right? So this is what I've done right now. So from the table, 4% super elevation, so this value, 60 miles per hour, so these two columns, and then N1 is 1, so this value. So from here, you get 107 feet. LR is 107 feet. So now we said super elevation runoff happens on the spiral curve. So the length of the spiral curve should be enough to accommodate super elevation runoff. So the length of the spiral curve should be 107 feet or more. Okay, so now we have three values, two from the equation of spiral curve and one from the criteria of the super elevation runoff. Okay, and these are the three values you can see it here. Okay, now from these two, from the equation of the spiral curve, I already know that I will pick 425.25 feet. Now I have another value from the super elevation runoff criteria, which is it should be 107 feet or more. So if I pick 425.25 feet, it is 107 feet. Right, but you cannot pick 107 feet because then it will not fulfill the one of the conditions, the spiral curve length. Okay, so the final length will be 425.25 feet, which is fulfilling all the three criteria, two for the length of the spiral curve and one for the super elevation runoff. So if you give 425.25 feet, you will fulfill both equations of spiral curve length, and you will also have more than enough length for the super elevation runoff. Okay. The other part is tangent runout. So tangent runout is when you are changing the normal slope to flat, normal cross slope to flat. So this is the equation, and you can see in this equation I'm using LR. So although LR happens after tangent runout, LR happens after LT. Okay, first of all you make it flat, then you change it to super elevation. So LR comes after LT, but in terms of calculation, you have to calculate LR first. LR will be calculated first. Okay, because you need in this equation. So LR is the super elevation runoff length. ED is the super elevation you want. And ENC is the normal cross slope. ENC is a normal cross slope. Okay, so you get the value of LT from here, and tangent runout happens before the spiral curve. That's why we call it tangent runout, because it is happening on the tangent. Okay, and again, you know, instead of using the equation, we can use the table as well. Okay, now in this table again, you have the, now why we have the design speed in the table? There's no design speed in the equation, see? Because the design speed will affect what? LR. Okay, so the table is given for the design speed, because on the basis of design speed, you will calculate the super elevation runoff, and then this is super elevation. Okay, and the value of normal slope is fixed at 2%. So to use this table, the normal slope is 2%. Okay, this table only works when the normal slope is 2%. Okay, otherwise whatever values you have, just put it here, and you calculate it. Okay. Now let us discuss the criteria side distance horizontal curves. Now when you started the topic of side distance, you said it's very important for design and drivers. All the locations of the highway must be checked for the minimum required side distance, all locations. Okay, so we discussed how we can incorporate the side distance in the design of the vertical curves. But if you look at the equations which we have discussed for all types of horizontal curves, side distance was not there. Okay, so we need to incorporate the side distance into some of the equations or of the horizontal curve, or we need to relate the side distance with the radius of the curve. Okay, so let us see how we can do that. First of all, you can see this is a curve, horizontal curve. The driver is at point A and he is looking at point B. Okay. So how much far he can see on the curve, that is his side distance, right? So side distance is the distance along the curve from A to B. What is A? The position of the driver. What is B? The position of the object which he can look at. Okay. Now his line of sight is like this, right? He is looking at point B in a straight line. Obviously his line of sight cannot be curved, right? If your line of sight is curved, that means you need to check with the doctor. Okay. This is not a movie that, you know, and this is good. From point A, point B. So his line of sight is making a straight line. Okay. Now, how can he look at point B? Because he can look at point B if there is no obstruction on the side of the road. Okay, so let's say this is the obstruction on the side of the road. Okay, the distance from the obstruction to the curve, they are calling it HSO, horizontal sightline offset. Horizontal sightline offset, HSO, horizontal sightline offset. This distance from the roadside obstruction to the curve. Okay, now this, if I move this obstruction closer to the curve, for example, if I move this obstruction here, okay, now can he see point B? No, the obstruction will come in the will interfere with the line of sight. How far he can see? He can see up till this point, maybe like this. Okay, so he can see up to this point. So his side distance, instead of going from A to B, now it is from A to this point. Let me call it B. Okay, so side distance reduced, right? A to B was more distance. A to B dash is less distance. Okay, why this distance reduced? Because I move the obstruction closer. Okay, similarly, if I move the obstruction here, then his line of sight can see more. Now you can see like this, which is up to, let's say, point C. So which one is more far? Which one is farther? Point B or point C? Point C is far. Okay. Point C is farther. I don't know whether this is the correct terminology, but farther. Yeah, farther. Sorry. So point C is farther from point B. Okay. So his side distance increased because I moved the obstruction away from the road, away from the curve. Okay, so the line of sight of the driver, the side distance of the driver can change if I move the side distance, sorry, the roadside obstruction closer or farther from the road. Now, see how we can relate it to the curve. Okay, let me do these things now. Okay. Okay, so let us say the angle made by the curve whose length is equal to the side distance is 2 theta. So 2 theta is the angle made by a curve having length equal to side distance. If you make a curve whose length is equal to side distance, we are calling the angle made by that curve as 2 theta. Okay. So if you take half of the angle, it will be theta. If you take half of that angle, it will be theta. Now, if you take this triangle, which is from A to the obstruction and to the center of the curve, A to the obstruction and to the center of the curve, this is a right angle triangle. In this right angle triangle, this is, I'm taking the angle of this theta, cos of this theta. Okay, so if you take the cos of this theta, it will be basically, okay, first of all, yeah, and one step before that, we're going ahead. But let me just finish it. Okay, so in this triangle, right angle triangle, this angle is theta because the total angle is 2 theta, so half of it will be theta. So if you take the cos of this angle, it will be basically perpendicular upon hypotenuse. This is a perpendicular. Base upon hypotenuse. This is the base. This line is the base. The vertical line is the base. And hypotenuse is the inclined line. Now from point A to the center, how much is the distance? R. This distance is R. So hypotenuse is R, radius of the curve. The distance from the curve to the center is also R at this point as well. Okay, but I don't need the full length. I need it from where? From here, from the obstruction to the center. So how much is this remaining distance? The total from the curve to the center is R, and then from R I should subtract this HSO. Okay, now if you go back to the figure which I showed you for the horizontal curve, we gave a name to HSO, a different name, which was M, middle ordinate. Okay, which was what? The distance from the curve to the chord. So curve is your side distance along the curve, and chord is the line made by your line of sight. Okay, so this becomes M, and in that figure for the side distance sketch, they call it HSO. So HSO and M are same. Okay. So basically, So the total distance is R. To get the base of this triangle, I will do R minus M. What is M? This distance. In the figure, they are showing it as HSO, but I showed you for horizontal curve, this distance is middle ordinate. Okay, the distance between the curve and the chord. So cos theta will be base upon hypotenuse. Base is this, which is R minus M, and hypotenuse is R. So cos theta equals to this. Okay, now to get the value of theta, I will use the basic equation S equals to R theta. What is S? Length of the curve. R is the radius. Theta is the angle of the curve. So we said the length of the curve is a side distance, which is S. R is the radius of the curve, remain as it is, and theta is equal to 2 theta. Theta equals 2 theta, right? Because theta is any angle. Theta is any angle. And for this curve, this angle is 2 theta. Okay. So the equation will become this. Okay, now in this equation, the 2 and the pi and 180 are constant. So we solve them. We take theta on one side, everything else on the other side. So theta equals to 28.65 into S upon R. So now I can pick this equation of theta and I put it as with the cosine here. So I will take the cosine of 28.65 into S upon R equals R minus M upon N. R minus M upon R. Okay. So I'll place the value of theta here from this equation. Okay. So this is what I did. Then I modified the equation for M. So M was taken on the left hand side, everything else on the right hand side. Yeah, and this is the final equation for M. Now M is HSO, horizontal sideline offset, as I said. Okay, so now you have the equation. This equation is between M, which is the middle ordinate or the obstruction distance from the curve, R is the radius of the curve, and S is the side distance. Okay, so the side distance depends upon the clearance of the obstruction from the road. So we have M here, and it is related to the radius of the curve, which is the design parameter. So now you have the design of the curve related with the side distance as well as the clearance of the object on the side of the road. Okay, so now you have the equation, design equation related to the side distance. Okay, if you don't want to use the equation, you can use this this figure as well. In this figure, you can see different curves are here. On the y-axis, you have radius. On the x-axis, you have HSO or M, horizontal sideline offset. So each curve is for a different V, and like we did for the K value of the vertical curve, If you know the v, then you can calculate the side distance. So with each curve, you can see the value of v as well as the side distance. Now, for example, your v is, let's say, 50 miles per hour. Again, unfortunately, this graph is also in feet and miles per hour. So if your v is 50 miles per hour and radius is, let's say, 1,000 feet, then how much clearance you need on the side of the road to maintain the side distance? So v is 50 miles per hour means this curve. Okay, and 1,000 feet is here. Okay, so from 1,000, if you come to the curve of 50 miles per hour, you are intersecting the curve at this point. And at this point, the value of, this is the curve, right? 50 is here. Sorry, here. Okay, so the velocity line for 50 miles per hour intersects the curve, the 1,000 feet y value at this point. Okay, this is a curve of 50 miles per hour speed, and this is a y value of 1,000 feet, which is my radius. So when at this value, the x value is 22 feet approximately. So you must have a side clearance of 22 feet to maintain the required speed on this radius. Okay, if you don't have it, then it will be dangerous and you cannot maintain the speed without causing any accident. Okay. Let us look at an example. We have a curve 240 meters connecting two lane highway. Posted speed limit is given. You have to find out the HSO or the M value because you want to put a billboard on the side of the road. Billboard meaning the advertisement board, the board on which you see the offers and everything. Okay, so this is very important for our life that we know what are the latest offers everywhere. Right, it is very important for our driving. Right. Then we can decide where we want to go. So they want to place a billboard and they want to find out how far this billboard should be from the curve of the road. Okay. Using the side distance criteria. So perception reaction time is given. The value of friction coefficient is given. Okay. So first of all, if I go to the equation, I'm trying to find out M. I need R and S. R is given 800 feet. Oh, no, sorry, 240 meters, and S is not given, so I have to calculate S. Now remember, when you are taking the cosine, you are taking the cosine of this whole thing. You are taking the cosine of this whole thing. So cos of 28.65 into S upon R. So first of all, do this, then take the cosine, then 1 minus, and then into R. Okay, remember this. So I have to calculate S first of all. Okay, so this is the equation for stopping side distance. V is 56 here, F is 0.35, T is 2.5, gradient is not given, so I will take it as 0. So stopping side distance comes out to be 74.2 meters. Okay, so for a speed of 56 kilometers per hour, I need a stopping side distance of 74.2 meters. Okay, and then I will use the equation for M, which is this equation. R and S both are known now, so M comes out to be 2.86 meters. Okay, so the billboard should be at least 2.86 meters from the curve to make sure that you have enough side distance on the road. Okay, now let us use the graph here, but the graph is in miles per hour and feet, so I have to change some units. Okay, so let us change the speed and radius into miles per hour and feet. Okay, let us change the P minimum is 0.2 meters, 0.2 meters or 0.66 feet, depending upon the units. Okay. The question which we did was in feet. So I took P minimum as 0.66 feet. If the question was in meters, then I will use 0.2. Okay. Now give me the conversion of speed and the radius. So convert the speed. How much is this? Yes, how much is speed? Okay, 34.78, but I will take it as 35 miles per hour because 34.78 is not shown in the graph. Okay, So I will take 35 miles per hour. So speed is 35 miles per hour. Now the radius. Radius is 240 meters. So convert it to feet. How much will it be? Feet. Okay. Now if I come to the graph. So 787 will be somewhere here. This is the line for 800. Okay, so you can put a scale on the y-axis and you can exactly know where is 787. Okay, and the line for 35 miles per hour speed is this one, the curve. Okay, so this curve reaches the graph at this point. The 787 feet is reached. So at this point, if you come down, the m value is almost 10 feet. The m value is almost 10 feet. So since the question is in meters, so I should convert the 10 feet into meters again. So 10 divided by 3.281 is how much? Okay, and the answer you got from the equation was 2.86. So these are very close to each other. Obviously, you did some conversion and then you took the value from the graph. So these values obviously will not be exactly equal, but you can see the difference is very small. It's almost, I think, in millimeters. 2.86 and 3.0 something. The difference is only in millimeters. Okay, so it's not a big issue. Okay. So you can use the graph as well, but you have to do some conversions. Just keep one thing in mind that in the graph, the speed values have to be rounded off to the values which are given. Okay. Like you cannot, if your speed is 32, there is no curve for 32. Okay. So that you, then you have to take for 30. Okay. You cannot interpolate for the speed in this graph. Okay. Because there are curves. You do not interpolate between curves. Interpolation for straight lines. For curvature, you cannot interpolate. Okay, so you cannot say I have a speed of 30 and then take a speed of 35 and then interpolate. No. Okay, you round it off, find out the value. Otherwise, use the equation. Otherwise, use the equation. Forget about the graph. If you cannot, if you have to interpolate, use the equation. Okay. Now, let us discuss the special facilities which are required for heavy vehicles. And these special facilities are required on gradients. I told you earlier in this chapter that whenever you have to provide gradients, then you have to make extra special considerations for heavy vehicles, because heavy vehicles face a lot of problem in moving up and down the gradient. Okay. So there are two types of facilities provided for heavy vehicles on gradients. One is for the upward direction, the other one is for a downward direction. Remember, I told you when we were discussing vertical curves, the highway has two directions. So if one direction is going upward, the other one is coming downward. Okay, so it's like this. So on the upward direction of the highway, you may provide a climbing lane. What is a climbing lane? It's an extra lane provided on the upward direction, upgrade direction of the highway, when the speed of the heavy vehicles reduce significantly. If you feel that speeds of the heavy vehicles reduce significantly, then for the upward direction of that highway, you can provide a climbing lane, which is an extra lane. Now, on which gradients the speed of the heavy vehicles will reduce? It's very simple. If the gradients are steep, the speed will reduce, or if the gradients are given or provided for a longer distance, then the speed reduces. Okay, we don't mean speed reduction, we mean significant speed reduction. So the actual speed is 80, but the heavy vehicle is going at 20 kilometers per hour. So this is significant. Then you give them an extra lane so they can move on in that lane and continue in that lane till they reach the end of the gradient. So the other cars, the other vehicles, which are the passenger cars, PC here means passenger cars. PC stands for passenger cars. So the passenger cars can travel at normal speed without being slowed down by the heavy vehicles. And since heavy vehicles are in their own lane, and in that lane everybody is going slowly because they are heavy vehicles, and the passenger cars are in the normal lane and they are going at high speed, so the chances of accidents are reduced. Chances of accidents are reduced because accidents often happen when the vehicles slow down significantly without any apparent reason. So there's someone coming behind you, okay, and you slow down. You slow down because there's a heavy vehicle in front of you. That driver may not be expecting you to slow down, he may come and crash with you. Okay, so when you provide a climbing lane, you increase the flow and speed of the passenger cars and you reduce their chances of crashes or accidents. Now, as I said, climbing lane should continue till the end of the gradient. This is obvious, right? Because till the end of the gradient, the heavy vehicles will be moving slowly. But when the gradient finishes, when the gradient is changed, now it is going downward or now it is mild or whatever happens. So if you want to discontinue the climbing lane, if you want to block the climbing lane, you will not block it abruptly. You should continue the climbing lane to some more distance so that the heavy vehicles can accelerate before coming to the main road. Okay, so as I said, when they were on the gradient, they were slow. Now, when they are coming to the main road, they should be coming at high speed so they can merge with the actual traffic flow. Okay, so if their speed were 20 kilometers per hour, they come back to the main road, and the main road speed is everybody is going at 60 kilometers per hour, they should be joining the main road approximately near this speed. Okay, otherwise they will have the same effect. Instead of slowing down everybody at the start of the gradient, now they are slowing down everybody at the end of the gradient. Okay, so we give them some extra length for the climbing lane, so when the gradient is finished they will have few meters to accelerate before they join the main road, so when they join they are joining at high speed and they will not slow down anybody else. Okay, when do we consider providing a climbing lane? When the total flow is more than 200 vehicles per hour and the heavy vehicle traffic flow is more than 20 vehicles per hour. So 220, how much? 10%, right? So basically the idea is if the traffic flow is more than 200 vehicles per hour and it has more than 10% heavy vehicles in it. So more than 10% is a lot. If there are only one or two heavy vehicles, then maybe you can manage. Okay, but if the total, if 10% of the total traffic is heavy vehicles, then you they will cause a lot of congestion. Okay, so then you should provide a climbing lane so that this slow 10% flow goes to that actually. Then we have emergency escape ramp, okay, which is again like a extra lane. But it is in the downward direction. And it is not a continuous lane like the climbing lane. It does not continue till the end of the gradient. Okay. The purpose of providing an escape ramp is if there's a truck which is coming down, this truck driver sees something from him which requires him to stop. Or there's a problem with the truck and he has to stop. Okay. But since he was going downward and the truck was heavy, and because of the weight and because of the gradient, the truck is now out of control. Out of control meaning now it cannot stop before hitting another vehicle or hitting any other object. So in that case, you provide an escape ramp to the truck so that instead of being on the road and hitting other vehicles, the truck will move on to that escape ramp, to that extra lane. Okay. So it will be off from the road. Okay, so escape ramp is to take the vehicle off the road, to take the truck off the road. Okay, so this is the main function of the escape ramp, to take an out of control heavy vehicle off the road towards an extra lane. Okay, now the design of this extra lane is such that it should help you or should help your truck or the heavy vehicle driver to stop as well, because eventually you are off the road, so you are not hitting anybody else. But your safety is also important. If the truck doesn't stop, eventually it will hit something and it will damage its own, it will get damaged itself, and the driver will get injured or may die as well. So we have to prevent that as well. Huh? Even the truck driver is a human being, even the truck is a vehicle, and so on. So we have to protect them as well. So the design of the escape ramp, the end design of the escape ramp is something, is one of these things. Okay, either it can end up at a sand pile. Okay, so truck will come here, it will hit the sand pile, it will stop then. Okay, it's a sand pile, so it's a soft material, so it will not cause much damage to the driver or the vehicle. Okay, or you can provide a downward gradient like this, but you can see the surface, they made it rough. So the highway surface was, and it comes from a rough surface, so it, eventually it will help to slow down and stop. Okay, or you can reduce the, you can make the surface rough and also reduce the slope as well. So instead of making it downward, you make it horizontal. So down with downward gradient, it was having problems in stopping. So at horizontal or level gradient, it will become easier for the driver to stop. Okay, or simply you can make it upward. Make it upward, so it will be better, even better. Okay, so any of these three things can be used. The main thing is the end of the ramp, escape ramp, helps the driver to stop. Okay, so these are the special facilities which you provide for the heavy vehicles. The climbing lane for the upward direction, and for the downward direction, you provide an escape ramp. Okay, now if you have any questions, you can ask me, otherwise I will go for the attendance. Okay, Allah is not here. Muhammad Al-Ajab. Okay, Zahra is here. Balqis Muhammad. Balqis Muhammad. Mahdi Abdul Ilah. Hala Munir. Mahdi is not here. Hala is not here. Okay, fine. Muhammad.
Yes, doctor.
You are Fatma.
Oh.
Huda is here. Omar is here. Okay, Omar.
Yes, doctor. Yes.
If you want to change your name, you can do that.
sorry.
Manal, Yasin, Muzun, Faisal. Not here. Moon Faisal is here. Noor Tawfiq of Muhammad Jafar. Noor Tawfiq Muhammad Jafar is here. And okay. Wasan Rafiq and Bayan Kadan. Wasan Rafiq Bayan Kadan. Not here. Section one, Ola, okay. Who else from section one? Anybody else from section one? Done? Okay, fine, good. Alhamdulillah. So see you guys on Sunday. Have a nice weekend.
Victor.
Yeah.
In the runoff length in the table. There is two. We take the one or two?
No, one and two is number of lanes.
So that's giving in the question.
Yeah, how many lanes are rotated? Either they will give total number of lanes. So half of that will be N1.
Okay, that's so the N.
For example, if you go to the example, they said two lane highway. So I took N1 as one.
Okay.
For one design speed, you have two values in the table for two different values of N1. Okay. The one and two are the values of N1, which is half of the lanes of the highway.
Okay. So if it's four line, the N will be two.
Two, yeah. Okay. And if it is more than that, then you have to use the equation. Then you cannot use the table.
Okay.
Okay, done?
Yes, done.
Okay, assalamu alaikum.